Introduce you to Aline Decadi. She's a system engineer at the European Space Agency, and today she will present one of your side projects on the evolution of crew safety criteria for future space transportation systems. And you also published a paper about this not so long ago. So yeah, I'm very glad for Aline to be here today. I think it's interesting also for us at EPFL because we have a big bunch of students passionate about, I would say, space exploration and the crew working on the analog mission for students called Asclepios. So I'm sure also if some of this team is there today, they will also learn about this and be able also to apply it to their projects. So, Aline, I'll let you now start your presentation.
Okay, thank you, Emmanuel.
A few housekeeping things. So the question we'll take at the end, you feel free to write them in the chat. Also, we'll be recording the talk. So if you don't want to see your name or your pictures appearing, so try to remove or your video, remove it from the screen. But it means also you will be able also to have it afterwards if you need to relook at a certain point. Yes, and that's it. Sorry, Aline, go.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. So I will start my presentation. So yes, this is a paper that has been published 2 months ago in the Space Safety Journal. From the IISS Association, so the International Association for Advancements of Space Safety. And so I will present you the main outcomes of this study, which is the evolution of the crew safety criteria for future space transportation systems. So space agencies, just let me up. So space agencies and institutions have developed many safety regulations and standards. So as you can see here, it's just to represent the bunch of it. They present similar approaches for elaborating an hazard analysis based on lessons learned and best practices. And they also define different safety criteria. But they do not represent a common vision today for deep space exploration. So it's not something like a guideline that can be used for regulating deep space exploration. So they currently face this challenge of preparing future spacecraft to be certified for this purpose with regard to safety assessment process. That are not depending on the same national and international guideline, as you can imagine. So, and these multiple existing processes are not expandable to space exploration as such as it is today. So we are looking at the creation of a future safety regulation to send astronauts in deep space, and in this area, we are not having a standardized process today. So the question is, are we able to take benefit from another standard that has already proven its value and is based on another international consensus? So that's this answer that I would like to develop with you. Okay. So, well, it is proposed to take benefits from the civil aviation standardized process, which is called the IRP 4761. So actually it's, so you see on the right hand side, the scope of it. So aerospace recommended practices. Actually it is linked to other practices that are performed for the civil aviation process, but basically this is a set of methods for conducting a safety assessment process, which is standardized. and used worldwide. And at the same time, it's the most the world's most severe civil aviation standards. So it's enriched by decades of maturation and improvements, and as well as millions of flight hours per year. So the aim of this research has been to analyze the level of safety which is required for flying passenger aircraft and assess if potential commonalities with space can be used and adapt them for deep space exploration. So the implementation of the safety, the assessment process by itself implies tools that are analysis and methodologies, and also criterias. And these criterias are the one that we will develop deeper in this presentation to cover all the mission phases from liftoff to reentry. And yes, it covers also the launch preparation phases. So let's start by comparing the safety tools. So you can see here, so on the left hand side, you have the space procedures that are used basically in the NPR 87052B is the equivalent of what NASA is using for SLS. And on the right hand side, you have what is used for the civil aviation standardized process. So the one that I just presented you before. And in the middle, you have the similarities of the analysis and methods. So the analysis of this safety analysis between aviation and space show that the methodologies for safety assessment process are very similar and as based on the same tools in both areas. So no big news for this. But from the methodology point of view, the aviation impressive safety record could be used to guide improvements in safety as applicable for future exploration mission. And this is where we go now. So let's compare the criteria now, the logic of criteria, and try to build what are the criteria that we could use based on aviation to build the safety criteria, the logic of construction for space exploration. So assessing safety criteria for failure conditions for any scenario and system and mission phase is way more difficult to establish by comparison of aviation standard and space procedures. So indeed, the mission constraints are very different between civil aviation, civil aircraft and let's say spacecraft because of the specific environment and mission architecture. So what we are looking for is a transfer function that could be implemented in order to derive the safety criteria to certify a spacecraft for the future space exploration missions. So I propose to go through three main pillars. So the first one, which is on the back or the bottom of the slide, is the one. So the logic of construction of the safety criteria in aviation and its consideration for certifying a human spacecraft for and beyond a low Earth orbit. So to talk also about Moon and Mars. The second, which is on the left, is the mission characteristics to be considered for a space exploration. So the one that mainly differ from aviation due to the specific environment and mission architecture we need to face in space. So this will be used as an input of this process. And finally, the output of this process, which is on the right side, is the illustration of the set of derived criteria applicable to a spacecraft design and based on the implementation of this process, so based on the inputs and the prism by itself, which is the construction of the safety. So let's start with the first one, the first pillar, So the prism by itself, so the transfer function for building this logic. So here is the way of maturation, this civil aviation process that I showed you before, which is called also FAR and pre-FAR regulation in the US. And so this maturation has been developed in order to mature the safety criteria applicable to any aircraft worldwide. So what is this construction logic used to ensure a safe design in aviation? So that's the one that we use. First one is the design mechanism that are built in, automatically triggered by failure and capable to eliminate or reduce harm by using redundancies, control of these functions, so such as the design approach of a failure and isolation that you could see in the mission architecture you work on. The second one is the qualification testing against environmental conditions. So it provides control means of ensuring the performance characteristics of the aircraft equipment in conditions that are representative of those that may be encountered in operation. So the qualification testing is performed once to qualify the design, basically. Then you have the certification of the aircraft manufacturing design. So it ensures that aircraft is manufactured according to an approved design. And that design ensures the compliance with the airworthiness requirements. So basically the airworthiness certificate is used for each aircraft when demonstrated as conformed to its type design. So that's why you have a certificate for the A380 and another one for the A320. It's obviously not the same configuration of planes, so you don't have the same certificate, that's it. And you need to obtain the certificate for both independently. And the fourth one is the operational maintenance in order to continuously guarantee the aircraft airworthiness in a control frame and with dedicated procedures and unit tests. And these design principles and techniques are typical rationales of the elaboration of a consistent set of safety criteria in aviation, which in turn are aiming to at mitigate failure conditions. So now that we have this prism, which is building the logic for translating the aircraft consideration into a set of safe criteria for guarantee the crew safety. Now let's go and see how we can apply this logic to space exploration. So here we enter in the second part, which is the input of this process of elaboration of safety criteria. So let's take the key specificities of a space exploration mission that have to be considered while expanding the safety assessment process from aviation to space. So they have been identified as the main element of differentiation compared to the main aircraft missions. And so the specificities, as it is written on this slide, are reside mainly into mission duration, mitigation options in flight after the loss of the failure tolerance capability, the reusability of the transportation vehicle that can be partly or fully, the environmental flight condition. We said it a little bit, but we will see this in more detail. And the service experience. The service experience is the available lessons learned on ground or in flight, used to understand anomalies from the past and continuously improve the safety assessment process by itself. So they are used as an input of our process. And now let's see the third part, which is the set of applicable criteria once we go through the prism of the elaboration of the safety. So passing this mission characteristic through this prism enables to translate the characteristics of the mission into a set of safety criteria that will be applicable to the design. And so it provides a level, let's say a level of abstraction that is actually common to aviation in space. Because first, it supports the safety assessment process by bringing the failure probability down to an acceptable level. So in particular for the critical functions that have catastrophic failure conditions and leading potentially to the loss of crew or the loss of mission. And at the same time, it could be implemented without without adding complexity in a way that the overall design will be compromised. So that's why it's proposed to apply this logic to space mission scenarios, in particular for the challenge of a 2-year mission to Mars, so that you will see a little bit what it should give when we go through this analysis and propose here to implement this process to both aviation and space exploration mission with a few illustrations. So let's go for this. So the first criteria that we proposed just before is the duration of mission. So let's see what are the proposed criteria related to the duration of mission. So the duration, as you can see here, the duration of an aviation mission is typically ranging from a couple of hours for a domestic flight to almost 18 hours for a transoceanic flight. So for this reason, the aircraft has to be qualified for extending operation that we call this ETOPS qualification. And an example of this applicable criteria is that the propulsion system should be designed to be tolerant to a failure in order to be able to reach at any time the closest airport and be able to live with one engine at least. So currently, if we go through this process and currently go farther, let's go to the ISS, so at the altitude of the ISS. So the active duration of flight, actually only the flight, which is you don't count the time you spent on the ISS by itself, which is a passive duration of flight. So here, this is only the active duration of flight. Back and forth, it's at least 6 days. So it's what we put here as 144 hours. So during which the critical function of the spacecraft should operate continuously and safely in order for the crew to come back to Earth in case of necessity, in a time which is compatible with the defined timeline of the mission, typically 2 days. And an extrapolation of this logic of elaboration for Moon and Mars could lead to require to the spacecraft a built-in design that maintains a safe configuration in case of failure without interaction between the ground and the crew for a minimum of time that enables the crew to come back to the vehicle. So if we are in an EVA, assess the situation, put in place in a mitigation plan. So we could say that it takes, let's say, 24 hours to react. And therefore, the spacecraft should be able to perform what we call a continuous auto test and generate health status and powered active and standby equipment. So that's really the translation of what we need to to have a functional and performance requirement more tightened and to increase the reliability of the systems. So that's what we need if we look at the duration of the mission by itself. When we go through the other criteria, the second one, that was the mitigation options after the loss of the failure tolerance capability. So I put two consequences of this. So on the left-hand side, this is the interaction with the ground. And on the right-hand side, you have the crew maintenance capability. So let's start with the aircraft. So the aircraft is designed to be failure tolerant FT. So we say FT in flight. What it means that in case of a failure of a critical function, it has to end its mission and land shortly. So why? Because after the failure by itself, it becomes zero failure tolerant. And so it means that it won't be able to deal with another failure condition that could occur. So we don't take the risk and we come back, so we land shortly. In case of loss of one critical function during a space mission, coming back to Earth to land shortly is not an option. So it's not what we can translate easily. So the notion of maintainability of the flight safety is crucial prior to be able to end the mission and come back. So in the frame of the ISS mission, you have several possibilities to mitigate this. So you have elementary crew maintenance of the spacecraft, for example, mitigation of the loss of pressure in one compartment can be done by isolation of the damage one, and then you mitigate the leakage by itself. But you put first the rest of the systems, the rest of the station in a safe state, and then you manage the leakage by itself afterwards. There's another potential backup vehicle that can be used in case of imminent casualty risks. So this is, of course, a lesson learned post-Columbia shuttle accident. So you always have a capsule to come back. It's your safe vehicle and your backup vehicle. So regarding hazard mitigation, it implies nevertheless, a strong interaction with the ground and relatively low crew maintenance, because you have an interaction and communication with the ground, which is continuous. There's no decision that are made by the crew itself. They operate schedule and experiment and orders that are given by the ground. So this is yes, a strong interaction, and at the same time, low capabilities to change a lot of things inside the station. It's defined for another crew to come back to make this maintenance afterwards, but it's not for the crew itself when they are on their mission. So, in extrapolation of this logic of elaboration for the safety criteria, if we look at Moon and Mars, it could lead, for instance, to equip the spacecraft with backup propulsion system in case of failure on the main engine, in particular to return safely from the lunar orbit. And the auxiliary engine should be qualified to be switched on by the spacecraft, provide the thrust and the delta V that are necessary to come back to Earth in a time which is always compatible with the mission duration and with, let's say, positive propellant margins. That makes sense. And therefore, regarding the hazard mitigation by itself, it means that a lunar mission requires a certain crew autonomy with regard to the ground support. But nevertheless, the crew won't be fully independent. So implementing safety criteria could lead to preferably orient the design through what we call the 2FT capability for the critical functions that are really directly impacting the crew survival, and keep this only for this purpose, and use the 1FT consideration for the when the crew maintenance is possible, so you don't have to give too much complexity to your design. You use a very strict safety constraints for what concerns the crew survival, and for what can be linked to the crew maintenance when it's possible, to have possible consideration for 1FT capabilities, and use then the maintenance as much as possible. And in the frame of a mission to Mars, so that encounters a time delay up to 24 minutes with the Earth. So here we need to rely on the reliability of the spacecraft systems and equipment, as well as the crew maintenance capability that should be significantly increased. So the criteria could be the kind of criteria that would be proposed are to procure equipment spares, to be able to prepare to replace equipment during the mission, to be able to repair damaged equipment. So here there's a compromise to think between replacement and reparation. And consequently, if you can repair damaged equipment, you can also limit the number of spares that are needed. And after any repair of an hardware equipment, it should be submitted to an acceptance test procedures, as actually it is done for in aviation, in order to assess the functionality, the performance, and the reliability before the subsequent reuse of on the spacecraft. So this strategy of implementation of spare can prevent from requiring the 2FT requirement for all the systems. That may not be compatible with the overall mission equation of cost, mass, complexity, and risks. So it also helped to make this credible in terms of applications. Let's talk now about reusability. So what about the criteria of reusability? So I won't go into all the details in terms of reusability, but if you have any question, of course, let me know and we will discuss further. But just to let you know that the main things to remind is that in the frame of the mission to the Moon and Mars, it could be necessary to move towards, as you know, and it's very in this moment, to go through bigger reusability of the transportation systems, even a full one if it's possible, associated to a new capability of refueling in orbit. And this capability may be crucial to solve the economic equation because it helps not making the system more complex that compromise the overall program. That's basically what is behind this one. And I think that is the most well-known criteria that we are using today, because the crew module reused for the ISS are now, even with the Crew Dragon, is almost 10 times. So it's really something that becomes more and more the reference today. So here we go through the criteria with regard to flight conditions. So I have listed here in this slide the environmental flight condition in the air, and then I did the ones that are applicable in space. So for the air, for the aircraft, so you see the extreme air temperature and altitude, the weather operations, the lightning. So this ones for an aircraft, these flight conditions have resulted in the establishment of operating limitations, such as a maximum takeoff and landing weight, minimum takeoff distance, and design requirements also, such as the automatic recovery of the electrical or electronic system back to the normal operation in a timely manner after exposure to lightning. So this is something which is very well known and controlled today. In space, you have so the odors, the space vacuum, the radiation. MMOD is for micro meteorite and orbital debris, and gravitational forces and exposure to earth contamination and sand and dust. So in space, a particular condition is, for instance, the ionizing radiation environment. And this environment impacts particularly the avionic equipment, causing single events upset, bit errors, latch up. And an extrapolation of this logic of elaboration of safety criteria for Moon and Mars could lead to consider that these environmental flight conditions are going to become more and more extreme. So therefore, these more extreme flight conditions will have to be translated into increased design constraints. And in particular, we can talk about the system tolerance to failure. So in order, for instance, to prevent the electronic component from erroneous changes of state, that could lead to a catastrophic failure condition of one of the most critical function, like the safe spacecraft guidance during the journey. And also with regard to the crew safety and survival. So in order, for instance, to prevent from radiation with an internal shielding associated to the definition of a maximum level of exposure. So this is typically the way we took into consideration these flight conditions to propose criteria that are, let's say, compatible with Moon and Mars explorations without adding too many constraints. So we will really focus on those ones. So those are examples, and the other ones are treated also in the papers, but I won't go into all the details, but it's to give you a couple of examples. And yes, what about the criteria with regard to the service experience? So the civil aviation, so as we said before, is really enriched by millions of flight hours each year worldwide. And the service experience method is one of the methods used to collect flight data by accumulating a significant number of flights on the overall world fleet. And it's really important because it's done with all the nations, and it's part of it. All the nations are involved and give their and collect their data and share that data and anomalies. So it's done this way. And this data may then be used as a justification for continuous design improvements and modifications. So it enables to get an excellent understanding and control of the aircraft in its environment, always ask the crew. It's in own environment. And this environment surrounding the ISS, for example, is very well known. So the future mission to the Moon and Mars will partly benefit of it, except for the significant difference of environment, the solar flux, the lack of magnetic field, as well as for the current and ongoing scientific and robotic missions that can help us to interpret the impact of the environmental flight condition on the materials, equipment, and systems. So, the human survivability and adaptation to deep space can also be analyzed through analog missions that are simulations on Earth in representative conditions. So you can, for instance, train for your procedures, train for the use of the equipment by themselves, and really, and also for contingencies, and so the emergency procedures that are linked to these degraded cases. So it's not something that can be transposed as such, it is, but it can be used in different several parcels in order to make something usable as a lessons learned for human missions. To conclude a little bit on this presentation, so space exploration missions do not benefit today from continuous methods of lessons learned as fast as we can see on the civil aviation. So in this frame, the civil aviation really bring additional values to space, such as the use of procedures and analysis of mission constraints. So there's a possible transfer function, as we have seen in different illustrations here. So there's possible transfer functions between aviation and space when you take benefit of the specificities, so the mission characteristic of a space mission. So these two worlds have a lot of common points when we try to use this prism of process of elaboration of the safety criteria coming from aviation and use it for space exploration purpose. So passing this mission characteristics into this prism has enabled to provide some illustration of safety criteria that could be used to reach a global consensus between space agencies and institutions, as it is already the case for the aviation worldwide. So the real topic here is to try to put in a paper and in something which is possible to regulate by any nation, the safety criteria, the minimum of safety criteria with their specifications, in a way that industry can build a space transportation systems on it, as it is done today for civil aviation. So to conclude, so space is attached to proven design, but has not a lot of lessons learned in service compared to the aviation that can bring these lessons learned for reusability, sustainability, and safety. But both worlds are feeding each other. So the aviation standards, the tools and the criteria used for safety assessment process are valuable to possibly achieve this global consensus and regulate future deep space exploration missions. And so that's why we have today a set of safety criteria that can be reviewed by these international nations and used as a first reference for putting one step further to this regulation that everybody's tried to elaborate for deep space missions with humans.
Great, thank you, Aline.
Thank
for
you.
This really fascinating talk. I see that people were kind of shy to ask questions in the chat. So I don't know if someone has a question and would like to raise your hand. Don't feel shy. Mm-hmm. Is the moment to... okay, so I see we have Peter. Maybe you want to ask your question.
Yes, question. First of all, thank you for a very excellent presentation.
Thank you.
I think, indeed, for future space, deep space, it's going to be very challenging. What areas of the spacecraft or of operations do you anticipate will be the most difficult and critical to get the crew safety and redundancy right?
Yeah, I can see that the most difficult criteria to be achieved will be the, let's say, the quantitative risk for casualties. So let's say the loss of crew for one mission or for X mission. So this is something that makes a lot of debate today. Of course, there's a way to secure the systems as much as possible, but there's no zero risk. It was not the case in aviation. It was not the case for ISS. It won't be the case for Moon and Mars. There's a certain level that we are using by default to really reduce the probability to an acceptable level, and so refuse to lose the crew for this kind of missions. But at the same time, the zero risk doesn't exist, and there will be a consensus to reach not only on the space transportation systems, but also the link, of course, linked to this, to the crew casualty, the one which is proposed by some governments. And we all, today, the international nations don't have the same vision on this. So that will be something that will take more time to regulate. But at least if we can start with having a space transportation that has the good level of reliability and enable the people to mitigate their own risk when it occurs, at least we will reduce this in a way that it could make the consensus for everybody. And for example, I think about the fact that for the first mission to Mars, we are proposing to send several missions first that are only cargo in order to give the necessary spares to the people and at the same time review the landing process of these missions without any crew inside. So with a lot of objectives already, but not the ones linked to the crew safety. So it would help a lot to reduce and really converge on something which is feasible and close to what we have anticipated by, let's say, by our analysis and lessons learned.
Thank you.
Cool, thanks. I see we have a question in the chat. Yeah, maybe you want to stop sharing yours. You can stop sharing maybe the...
Okay.
The chat was, from Nazar Ahmed. What challenges are involved in extremely long space missions? So I guess it's going beyond the Moon and Mars.
Yes. So extreme long mission, it means that you have to really be autonomous. So the autonomy by itself is something huge. It's first the life support. So everything which is linked to oxygen, production of water, CO2 release and extraction. So how do you deal with it when you come from somewhere else, or even if you have mission cargoes before? You have a limited quantity for these things that are so important for your survival in the long term. So these are the ones that need to be really the focus on the next technology to be put on the table. So of course, the space transportation system by itself is crucial. You can't do anything without it, but generating your water and be able to extract the molecule and use this in a way that you can have your water, extract what is necessary to have your oxygen, the CO2, extract the oxygen from the CO2, etc. So you can ensure by your own technologies on board, your own life support criteria.
Cool. Yeah, thanks for this answer. Then I see another one that we had on the private chat. Do you think that the international space community could reach agreements on the safety standards based on AC, I guess it's aviation, civil aviation safety?
Yeah.
And what incentives are there for such an agreement?
Yeah, so actually, yes, they achieved for commercial human-rated systems. So commercial is if you want, for instance, do a suborbital or orbital flight. So there's already a regulation that has been recently released by the international space safety community. So actually, when you see where I have been published is the IIISS. So and they have used all the advancement that they did in space safety to release this commercial human-rated system certification, and which is available for download on their website. And this is the first one. So that was a big work and with all the international communities on this. And this is really a good stepstone because it deals also with different criteria, but always with the same ideas that at some point it will be used as an extrapolation for the other one. So also talk about the crew survival and the quantitative aspects behind.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks. The follow-up question, I think, is a bit linked with when you were talking about commercial companies, is how are new space companies fit into the picture of developing new space standards? Mm-hmm. So these days, many SMEs are developing new tech that directly feed new services expected in the near future. And how to balance standardization / regulation with the creation of new markets in space?
Yes, so I think that it helps a lot when you if you talk about the use of the new markets that are proposed when you talk about moon, for example, is the use of minerals, the helium-3. So some of the people want to go there also to use let's say the moon. The soil as a collector for being able to make the assembly of very big things and when come back to the earth. So like FedEx or Amazon's could do on the moon. But when we want to make this credible, we need to think about what is necessary for any technologies to go there. And so you can see that what is presented here, the fact that we need reliability, you need to think about how the things will be operated in order to train this before going there, and also to be sure that you know how to make them land on the soil. And so for the moon, it's one aspect, but for Mars, we don't have achieved this goal yet. So you see that you have several let's say representative aspects that you would like to do exactly as you do on Earth, but it's not something that is transposable as is. So yes, we need here to accept that if we put some regulations that are applicable for everybody and sufficiently general to give what is important, but without restricting everything to a complex of requirement that no one will use. That's really the challenge of it. And if we achieve to make it, when we talked at the time of the civil aviation, I was not, we were probably not here at this time, but it was super impressive. I found so many papers on this, and the way that they achieved to make a wording which is at the same time open to new technologies, but also giving the good level or the good limits around it was something key. So it's of course necessary to make this with experts that know exactly what they say and that don't want block new technologies, but want to accompany and make them good and make them succeed in this new world, new market.
Thank you for this passionate answer. We have three more questions. That's good because we are still in the time. So what have been the new safety requirements introduced as a consequence of reusability of launchers and spacecraft for manned mission?
Yes, so the reusability, so it means, so the one that has been introduced is the several engine concepts. So as you can see, when you see, for example, I don't know, but Crew Dragon is a good example because it was with Thomas Pesquet, so I will use it. But the fact that you use multi-engine propulsion is something key. At the same time, this is still what some experts say, that it's one propulsion system. Of course, we don't use as we were doing on Apollo, launching two missions at the same time, two rockets, and see if there are one that that goes in orbit. But that's because we have sufficient reliability on one system to say that it will go. So it's less risk in one sense, because it's more reliability point on this with failure conditions that are really mastered today. So that's something that has been key. Our propulsion system for me is key in for reusability. There's nothing more. Of course, the trajectory, as you know, for coming back, but it's again a problem of propulsion and management of propellant. So.
And the next question, for longer stay and long flights between planets, I don't see our current energy problem as a solution in and of themselves, be it the drive or maintenance of bases on the moon or Mars. It's more a comment than a question, I guess.
Yes, I think yes, because I'm not sure I understand. But that's true. We need, there's a lot of work that is done on the energy and consumption and the generators that we use. We could start, let's say, light, because it's not a question for having 200 people in the 10 years to come, but it's something that yes, needs to be thought bigger. Mm-hmm. But at the first step, I think that it would be done for a crew, let's say, with different mission that comes one by one, but not for a village, as we can anticipate today.
And now there's more programmatic question. What is the position today at ESA about developing human spaceflight capabilities, launcher and vehicle in Europe?
Yeah, so that's I won't be able to talk for the Moon and Mars strategy people at ESA, but what is planned today at ESA is to work on the Artemis mission. So as you know, today we have several modules that are achieved by ESA for the Artemis missions. And so there will be a big collaboration of ESA with NASA to collect samples and return with the samples safe back on Earth. So that's something which is very used because it's already endorsed and agreed, and it makes us a very important agency and collaboration for going to the moon. So that's huge, actually.
Cool. Yeah, thank you. And then I think in order to close, we have a last question from myself. I'm very curious. Can you tell me more about this spacesuit behind you?
So yes, this is my spacesuit this way. Yes. With my telescope. So yeah, actually, I'm working on the preparation of my next Mars analog mission that will be end of this year. Mm-hmm. And so I prepare my combination to go on the field and be able to collect samples and work in a Martian representative environment. So that's why I'm preparing my combination. Okay. And I'm training with it to see if the hardware work well with
So in remote, so at home, you're training with your spacesuit.
Yes.
That's amazing. Thank you. I think, I see in the chat there was one last question and we have still 2 minutes, so maybe I'll take it. Right now, SpaceX is supervised by NASA for crewed missions, but will it be possible for a private company to launch its own mission with its own safety criteria, disregarding international or USA regulation?
Oh, that's complex to launch your own mission. You need to have your own rocket. So I think that if you're not linked with an agency from anywhere, let me know how you do that. I don't know.
No, I guess it's like maybe cars today. You cannot really put a car on the market without any certification. So
no, you can't. No, mm-hmm. No. Today there's so as you can see, for example, for the Crew Dragon, for instance, because it's maybe the most easier to understand and illustrate. This is the FAA that also gives the certificate. So this is still the aviation and governments of civil aviation that gives the certificate for them. So yeah, there's always a certification agreement, and if you don't have it, you don't go.
Okay, cool. Thank you. So I guess we'll close it now. Thank you so much, Aline.
Thank you very much.
Presentation. It's always a great pleasure talking to you. And I guess if people have questions, they can always reach out to you.
Of course.
Or you can send us to eSpace an email, and then we'll transfer also to Aline. And I'm sure she will be happy to follow up.
Yes, of course.
Thank you so much. Take care.
Thank you.
Goodbye, everyone.
Have a good day.